data available today from big data to get the good accuracy in machine learning. Okay, I think it's clear. And what is learning? Learning, there is three currently model method of learning. Supervised, it's similar when a student learning. There is a teacher give a material for learning, and then the teacher test to the student about the learning. This is a supervised learning. For example, regression, nearest neighbor, super vector machine, etc. Some application, massive MIMO channel, etc. Supervised learning. The other is unsupervised learning. For example, it is clustering. There is no label in unsupervised learning. So the model must grouping the data into some group. It means that this model didn't need a teacher or a supervisor to learn some knowledge. So this is only use their own techniques. For example, Kamin, FCMin, etc. to clustering. This is usually we call clustering techniques. And the current research is a self-supervised learning, or sometimes recurrent supervised or self. This is similar to a child. Before they go to school, they learn by he or her, him or herself, without teaching. So self-supervised learning is this method create its own label based on the data. So this is interesting method today, self-supervised learning. The pioneer is Yan LeCun. This is describe the peak of the method of inference. There is a runtime or a batch mode. Okay, we continue. Now we come to undergraduate machine learning research. Okay, this is only my own view based on the some reference. The undergraduate machine learning research is the implementation of machine learning theory. Also include another materials, for example, programming language, web design, software engineering, algorithm, data structure, and so on. So for undergraduate, the student must learn some basic skill because there is 4 or 5 years. So the student must learn, for example, C++ as the core programming language. And we have a vocational or diploma and academic schools. And now we have to the student have to get the competency certificate instead of just academic certificate, and with level of 5 and 6. So for undergraduate student, they must not only get the mini thesis or final task, they have to have the skill for competency for in Indonesian standard BNSP. The contribution of just undergraduate is the implementation or implementation of the theory and a development or making an application. So the output of this undergraduate machine learning research is for domestic conference or local campus student journal or campus repository. But if the research want to present in an international conference, that must be something contribution or innovation or novelty in this research. This undergraduate machine learning research is usually custom a model to solve existing problem in an organization, usually continue from field their field practice in industry, and it's in line with Nadiem Makarim project at Kampus Merdeka. This is there is a correlation between campus and industry. There is two kind of undergraduate vocational course, just a practical hand-on training and learning tangible skills. For example, is create a machine learning application to support business management, etc. This is the vocational course. They learn many current technology instead of technology to support the business management or another organization. And for the academic course or S1 are more likely to demand essays and logical reasoning. There are, for example, there are some problem in existing machine learning system in an organization. For example, low accuracy, fail errors in some condition, or maximizing the profit, etc. The student should propose machine learning to overcome the problem. This is the academic course. So there is a problem to for getting the higher accuracy and for other problem, for example, bottleneck, etc. So there is the student need another skill outside the machine learning. For example, how to writing and use the logical paragraph in his final task or mini thesis. Okay, tips number one is for me is the language and framework we choose. This is a tip for undergraduate. Okay, we see that there from 2013, there is a popular language. There is a C++, it's the famous language, but there is a popular language, for example, JavaScript and Java. Yeah, also the Python, that is year by year, 2015, there is Java and Python want to overcome the famous of JavaScript. All the language is good, but of course, if you are a teacher or lecturer, if your student propose, sir, I want to make a machine learning using a C++ or assembly language, you should not reject it because this is the fast, C++ is fast languages, for you have to say to this student to you must to give a progress report every week or every month, because if 1 month there is no progress, you should call the student to change the language, because it has potential their immune system for the pandemic. So you have to choose for them the easy language, for example, Python. Or you say there is another math, for example, MATLAB. Okay. And what is the framework? Framework is a method using some programming language to create a complete application. Similar language, maybe there is a different framework. For example, if PHP, we know the Code Igniter, Laravel, Jen, and for Java, for example, Jakarta Struct, etc. And in 2013, Ruby and Rails is the famous one. So I learned this language, this framework, sorry, in doctoral course. As a lot of students complain about why you using Ruby and Rails, not Java or PHP. The teacher only said that there is a trend in 2013 using Ruby and Rails. Twitter, etc. is very dynamic and easy. If we create, for example, a student class, student table, the Ruby and Rails will create the truth or create, read, update, delete button easily. But now the Ruby and Rails is lower because there is another framework that easy to understand. For example, the Laravel. The Laravel is a PHP based framework, and also Code Igniter is famous and good enough to implement the machine learning based framework. Because for undergraduate student, undergraduate research, the student have to create some model or application, not only to use some method, but they have to create some simple application, and because some industry will hire them to create or maintain their application or their system. 2015 and 17, and there is a Meteor and Laravel. Then Django and Flask is the framework using Python. So we will discuss this later. 2018, and the Laravel is the famous one. And Ruby and Rails is lower down. There is another, for example, Node.js. It is also good. Okay, this is the illustration of for famous language. For example, C++, they have the characteristic good in efficiency, speed, and memory allocation. And Java with its platform independent, and Python with less typing, provide new libraries, fast prototyping, and several other features. MATLAB is the toolbox and function for easy to create the machine learning. But the problem about the library, toolbox, and function is set, and we will discuss later in for graduate or postgraduate research. Okay, we see that there is a increasing the trend in Python usage. You can see it in the Google trend. There's a and now the Python is the first famous language. But of course, some C++ language is still in use in a vendor, the famous vendor. For example, TensorFlow, they use C++ in their library. So for undergraduate student, the C++ must be learned because this is the core of a language. But if the final task or mini thesis, skripsi, okay, the student might be need the language that near the vendor usage or industry, maybe Python, Java, or PHP is good for the student. Okay, tips number two is the machine learning framework. There is a lot of machine learning framework. For example, TensorFlow. TensorFlow is from Google, Google Brain Team, and 2015, written in C++, Python, and CUDA. CUDA is in GPU, usually graphic processing unit. The platform is Linux, Mac OS, Windows, Android. It is the most all platform is can be used TensorFlow. Cross platform development, which is the good characteristic. And then as Apache Software Foundation is mahout in using the platform Hadoop. If you have learn the big data, you must be now the Hadoop. This is the elephant symbol in this method. And next, Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit. This is the Microsoft Research 2016, written in C++ and Python, Windows, also Linux. And now there is a automated machine learning. They created Azure AutoML, and Google also have the Google AutoML, automated machine learning. Okay, we next discuss. And there is also a cafe too. This is Berkeley, this is university. 2017 using C++, etc. And another framework from Apache Singa. 2015, the Aztec Logical System. This is a distributed training. This is the based on network. Okay, this is the machine learning framework. And the student for undergraduate, just also understand the web application framework. For example, Flask, Django, Cast, Battle, Fancy, Giotto, etc. But two famous one is Flask and Django. Django is for enterprise, Flask is for micro framework. But the Flask is the more famous than Django because there is a do not hint at an using a hammer. If you only use a simple machine learning, you get Flask. If the machine learning is bigger and bigger, the Flask can also follow the problems. But for Django, we also usually use for enterprise, so bigger system than Flask. But of course, we also can use Python machine learning inside PHP and other machine using API. API is application program interface. Most system today is use this characteristic. For example, chess.com or lichess.org. They can be accessed using Android, using web or browser, or on board. For example, Genos. Genos is the server content train data for deciding COVID or non COVID, and the Genos model can send the request to the server to detect the positive or negative. Or this is a student must understand is for undergraduate. Of course, not all the system. Maybe they focus only on Android, on web, or instrument, Now we next to for graduate machine learning research. This is not only implementation of machine learning theory, but also Okay, the machine learning research for graduate is master and doctoral school. Increment improvement and substantial innovation for competency level is 8 and 9, but it's not not doctoral or master student you provide this competency because it's only 3 or 2 or 3 years, and this focus for to method improvement. This is if the student focus on technical, the method improvement, accuracy, speed, lowering the cost, etc. And or focus on domain implementation. For example, machine learning for COVID-19 detection, machine learning for prediction of spread, COVID spread, etc. This is the domain. But for the internal conference or journal, the student must discuss and research and discussion focus on one or two. For example, if the student focus on the method of technical, the research and discussion will be discussed this, for example, the accuracy, the efficiency, etc., and comparing the other method. And if the master or doctoral student focus on domain implementation, in his or her research and discussion focus will the implementation, how to solve the problem, the accuracy in his domain, not focus on technical because the student decide to domain implementation. This is the student must understand this characteristic in, for example, in especially in graduate machine learning research. The output is internal conference or international journal, maybe one or two in high impact factor or high quartile, quartile one and quartile two. Usually the method, first method improvement is a high quartile. But now the research in characteristics of domain implementations also have the key one or key two impact factor. You can see in Scopus or Google Scholar or Schemago. For master degree, is the compare, test, and enrich the MM machine learning theory. For example, find some appropriate machine learning methods to support business management, etc. So we not only use one method, we use some method for comparison, and we recommend one the appropriate for the appropriate system for the support business management. And for doctoral degree, it is develop and finding a new theory, find new method or making a hybrid from some method to improve the accuracy, speed, and other performance, technical or method improvement. Or this is the second kind of research, implement machine learning in another area, for example, in health, in security, in education, environment, etc. Of course, the student must understand the domain application of the implementation, understanding the health, the security, the education, for example, e-learning or mobile learning, understanding the environment problem, planning problem, etc. Okay, tips number one for graduate. Actually, the graduate student not only from computer science, so maybe they from another science. So we have to choose the easy IDE. For Python, for example, we can use the Anaconda Navigator. This is good, but mostly this is a slow response. You have to use a good laptop or a good computer to run this. There is an environment learning, and there is also a community. In Anaconda Navigator, there is also a Jupyter and Spider, and the framework to create simple application. And there is many source or book and ebook you can learn. For example, this is my book, Data Mining Using MATLAB or Python. The MATLAB is still in use in research or in journal because the MATLAB is stable, and they similar to what is alat ukur thing. From proof the method, and also the Python is free of charge or open source. MATLAB is you have to pay a license. Anaconda also give the easiness in improv environment. What is environment? Environment is if we install the Python in our laptop, there is more than environment to make the Python light. Because for example, I use environment, the name is TensorFlow. This is contain the library or only support the, for example, TensorFlow or neural network. We can also use another environment for our purpose. For example, Nusa Putra for NLTK atau Natural Language Processing Problem. This library only contain text mining, etc. So by Anaconda Navigator, we can easily change our environment by clicking here. For example, I want to run my PyTorch environment. They will switch the environment to PyTorch, and we can see the library supporting this. But of course, we have to install appropriate library for our purpose. This is the Anaconda Navigator. But of course, if you already understand this environment, and you can also use the command prompt. This console is more faster than using the Anaconda Navigator. I actually prefer use this console because it's more faster to access the environment compared to using the Anaconda. So this is maybe a half minute and half to open this environment. So I will back to this environment. We need some 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 1 minute to change this environment. So this is very annoying. So I prefer to use the command. Below is the illustration how to use this console or command prompt. Conda deactivate. Conda activate, for example, in Nusa Putra. Change base to the Nusa. Base is if we install the Anaconda in the first time, we only have one environment called root or base. You can add another environment by clicking the create or by using this command. It's similar, and you can also see the library in environment, for example here version. There's a lot of it's similar to right side here. This is the installed library, but it is using a command, but it's more faster. I suggest you to use the command. And tips number two, choose an editor. For example, a Jupyter Notebook. Another editor maybe can be used, for example, Sublime Text or maybe a Notepad can be used to editor. But Jupyter Notebook can be accessed using a browser. And this is support by Anaconda Navigator. And also this is very interactive because we have some cells. For example, cell number one, if we run this only run this cell. For example, next we run the next cells, next number two, we continue this process of running. It is very useful. We can trace easily where is the if there is an error. We can find where is the location of the error. And this editor is adopted by Google as their web-based editor called Google Interactive Jupyter Notebook, or some people say Google Colab. This is the adoption of Jupyter Notebook by Google. Okay, the next is Google Colab. Yeah, this is a Colab research Google. Google not only provide the editor, but also its processor. Not only CPU, but also GPU, graphic processing unit, GPU, and tensor processing unit. So there is a link here. If we clicking this, okay, we see the this is Colab research google.com. We don't need to install something. We only just use a browser and also tablet or handphone. You can use this. But also you have to add some accelerator, GPU or TPU. And then we run cell by cell. For example, this is TensorFlow version 2. And if there is an error, the system will give you the notification. There is a import a library. For example, TensorFlow is a library. Okay, we found GPU. This is not my GPU. This is a Google GPU. And then we compare GPU and CPU with some TensorFlow application, Keras, TensorFlow and Keras. With GNN or convolutional neural network, and Google said that the speed using GPU is more than 30 times faster than only CPU. That's serial. This is a parallel. So there is for using CPU, we 2.7 seconds. Oh, this is a 67 more faster using a GPU than CPU. I think the Google has expand their GPU, but of course there is a limitation for using the Google machine. Maybe a 24 hour, they will close, will stop if our machine still running, except if we pay the license. Okay, this is that's a Google Colab, and also Google Colab provide us with a directory in Google Drive, so we can upload the data for training to this Google Colab temporary, or we can integrate in our Google Drive. Because if temporary, if we shut this Google Colab application, shut the browser, shut down the browser, then we have upload again. So if we link with our Google Drive, if we open this Google Colab, the data is still there. Oh, of course, you have to login first in your Google account to access the Google Colab. Okay. This editor can also be shared, to your team or your teacher or your student. There is as a tips three, there is an easy learn to machine learning by using Google. For example, I want to know how using a KNN. So you just typing in Google Colab and type the method Colab. For example, Colab KNN, and there is a result here. If you click this, you can see someone had already share this application. You can easily follow the how to use KNN model in a Python. And there's a main question. Is R library library function and good enough, especially for student in learning machine learning? This is a relatively difficult question. But must we use code from library function feedback or from scratch, from zero, or by your own code? And this is also the problem. To overcome to answer this problem, we have to learn first the object-oriented programming. Why we use object-oriented programming? Because the library in Python is created using a class in class. So if we use the, for example, import. There is import NumPy. The NumPy is a class. So to understand the inside code, we have to learn how to read the object-oriented programming. For MATLAB, we can use the function editor, or in the official site, there is some function code available here. Okay, how to find some source code of the library? This is a tips number four. First, there is, for example, we import the K-neighbors classifier. This is a classic clustering. There is a scikit-learn. Scikit-learn is scikit learning. There is some researcher join this to make some machine learning method implementation in Python. So we just click put the method in the searching in Scalm. And we will find the result. There is a scalar dot nightbirds dot there is it. This is the object characteristic. So it's mean that connect boards classifier is inside neck boards and also the neck board inside the escalator. Because there's escalator, you know, there is a lot of method aside the neck boards. And then we click here. There is a connect neck boards. This is actually how to use the function of this class. But for the postgraduate or graduate student, we have to know the insight of the canaries for neck plus classifier, not only just using this library or using this toolbox or some application. For example, we use a RapidMiner or Weka. For graduate student must understand the source. If the RapidMiner cannot be open the structure of the method, it is difficult for graduate student to modify the method, because especially for doctoral student, they have to modify the source to get a hybrid or to get the modification in a parameter or increasing the accuracy by using the proper or additional in, for example, in optimization. After we click the source, there is a, what is this, the GitHub. GitHub is the famous share source code. This is the official from Pascal Scikit-Learn. You see that they directly see the network classifier class. So you have to learn object-oriented programming. You can see in the YouTube or some ebook create object-oriented programming. By understanding the object-oriented programming in Python, you can see how the library flow.
Kan langsung okay. Bisa
pakai langsung minimal caranya ya. Jadi emang harus for example one characteristic of object-oriented programming function or method is there is a fit how the, you can see how this method is created in Python, but also of course there is some relation on one class to another class, so you have to follow if this class call another class, you have to follow another class to understand, because it's created by class diagram or object oriented program. If you scroll up, we see that there is in the top of the source, there is a contributors. Contributors is the usually from a vendor. For example, Nicholas Yip is a machine learning engineer, scikit-learn core developer working on PyTorch. PyTorch is a famous deep learning. This is at Facebook, Facebook AI. So you can ask if you want to learn more to this contributor, or you can become a contributor if you have the revision method or new method to propose. I don't see in Indonesian people here, and also in another. I hope there is a lot of Indonesian people contributing to the machine learning. Tip number six is using data sets. A lot of data sets are available today in big data era. For example, is Kaggle data sets. This is a contest to predict who is the method with higher accuracy. When I in doctoral as doctoral student, my teacher is forced me to use the Kaggle dataset and follow the contest, and I only get the number of 70 rank in the rank. The first one and second one will be awarded by some money, $1,000 in this Kaggle dataset. And until now, there is a email from this Kaggle to me to follow the contest again, but it's difficult. Eh? And two is Amazon dataset. Amazon dataset is also from big data from Amazon. Because some contest is create the new machine learning of all, for example, AlexNet, VGA is the winner of the contest. So our student will have difficult if we want to create a higher accuracy from the existing model, because this the famous model actually is the winner of the contest. So it's difficult to Indonesian student to make a competition to another researcher in the world. But it's not difficult, but not impossible, but difficult, but possible. Okay. And you see machine learning repository and Google dataset, Microsoft dataset, you can download freely. Send on from government dataset, from computer vision dataset, etc. Also in library, for example, scikit-learn available provide the data for learning and LTK and etc. This is you can use this kind of data. And last tips is using a future or new future trends. And this is useful for master degree or doctoral degree, because they have to get the contribution or novelty. Yeah. For example, machine learning to combat COVID-19, and also in future trend is improvement of framework. Some doctoral student create a framework. For example, Ruby and Rails is a framework, is a doctoral student dissertation. Machine learning for business forecast. And this is a self-supervised learning is still machine learning for biometric security, for example, in this COVID area, we cannot just touch fingerprint, we can use face recognition. How to get a good accuracy and security in this biometric. Also, automated machine learning. This is machine contain a lot of method, so they can analyze what best method for use for usage. For example, in Google automated machine learning, Azure, and so on. And also, future trend is explainable AI. For example, in the health, if we have machine prediction the cancer or not, we of course not give a doctor with a black box. Oh, you get the cancer. So the doctor need the reason, not only positive or negative, but also the reason. There is a report why this machine predict the people is cancer or not. Okay, this is explainable AI. The next is future NLP. This the machine can make a conversation to another machine. This is the conversational AI. And the last one is generative adversarial network. They also can generate the new face in the world. Face create some new generative adversarial network. Okay, last section we will some show you a simple machine learning process. For example, neural nets. We separate the learning and testing. This is the important for the beginners, because some student use learning and testing in some code, so they difficult. Well, the location where is the train model, so it's good for us to separate the learning and testing. The first time we also usually we use the import as usual, import nanti Keras, we use Keras, is sequential, and we upload this file to here. This is a simple, of course we cannot use this data, we have to use the big data here, but it is only for testing. Upload this file and then we need the data, training, validation, and testing. But usually we only two data. Actually, there is three data, training, validation, and testing. If we go to an organization and want to make machine learning, we get one data, and we have to separate this data into training and validation. For example, 80 for test training and 20 for testing. Or you can use cross-validation. We change testing become learning and learning become testing to make a high accuracy model using training and validation. But actually the testing is from existing data. The student have to come to the organization to get the new data, the testing, for test the model from training and validation. But in reality, some student only get the training and validation data and separate maybe 10% the data for testing. But actually the testing is the different data from when we get this, the first data. The formatting using Pandas and NumPy is the famous data structure in data structure management in Python, NumPy, Panda. PD is for the easy in typing. Actually, we use Pandas, but the PD is more, the Python is less typing, so there is some minimize abbreviation. This is the machine. The machine is contain a network, because this is neural network. If we use CSVM, this machine is SVM. We use naive bias. This is content and naive bias classifier. This machine is must be learned, because it's similar to baby. When it inborn, there is for example six layer where the neuron for each layer 64, 32, etc. And the final layer contain one output. So this is uses sigmoid. But for deep learning user, you can use SoftMax. SoftMax is good for multi-class, because this is only predicting the scholarship. You only use one output, get scholarship or not. But if you have many class, you usually better to use SoftMax with four. For example, for class, there is four output. and the winner is the prediction class. And then we use a hyperparameter. Hyperparameter is this is parameter and the optimizer ada optimizer and loss epoch is the hyperparameter. Yeah. This is in learning purpose. Compare with this. This is the parameter. Number of layer, number for activation function, etc. But this is a hyperparameter, optimizer loss, EPO, etc. And then we run and wait according the data. If you use Google Colab, Google Colab is faster, but when we receive and upload, there is any time. Actually, Google Colab is fast, but because we use NetPop, it seems slower than we use our laptop. But of course, we can use the GPU to faster. And by separate learning and testing, we get two file, YAML and H5. It contain the architecture and the weight and bias of the result. And then we can download because we have already import the library for download and upload the data. And the trained neural network can be used for another system for the next step. But we have already set the result. So this is the useful of separating the learning and testing. We can set first the trained networks. This is only run one time, but we also can run several time to get a better accuracy of this neural network, the trained neural network. This is useful for graduate student and for undergraduate student. For example, the problem is how to create the web application. This is how we use the famous Python framework. Plus, first you have to install the Flash in your environment using the Anaconda or by PIP, PIP install plus, etc. See the code in the official site of this framework. And then install the environment. Flash framework needs a Python code to run the server and some HTML as the interface in folder templates. So maybe there is at least three files. File Python and one file HTML for input and one HTML for output. Okay, for example, there is a one input and one output. This is only a simple application, but you can use this simple application for the higher according to your creativity. This is the import of library of Flash render template for make HTML like this and request for URL import pandas, numpy, etc. Of course, yes, Keras. This is a example. In this application, we don't train we have already trained in Google Colab, for example, and we have two train file, file YAML and file HPAP is the result from training the neural network, and we add these two file in the folder where the application these two file. This is the two train network here, and this is the Python to run the server. Okay, this is the actually the simple. We only use two file from train data, upload load model and compile, and then there is a render template. This is here, opening the JSTFTML, and there is two input. And if we click this button, the function will execute, will be executed, and there is a getting process from this input. For example, we call variable one. This is the template. You can also see this is the input. There is a input one and input two, and there is button. And this is the result. Rendering the template result the HTML. So and it's open, and there is a result of prediction. You see there is a interesting code here is called Jinja. Jinja is a simple library to insert Python code inside HTML. This is Jinja 2. That is a format percent, and this is the code. If we don't use the plus, we only see the result here. We just click. Result is here. But if we use the Python code, this code will convert to the Python process. Okay, we try to open the rest of kind of using Anaconda or using the console. Okay, we use the open terminal, TensorFlow, and you see there is the GUI.jst.py. This is where I will run this. Python, okay. Using TensorFlow backend, then it is they run the server. This is the machine or the model. And restarting the server with the port number 5000. So we just open the browser and this is the interface. We click prediction, there will the give the answer. You can see that if we compare with directly accessing, there is a year, but using a Jinja, they calculate, they run this Python script in the HTML with the result is here. Of course, this is the only the simple application. So student can enrich this application. For example, using CSS or Bootstrap to get a beautiful presentation of the browser. And another kind of application is training in web. The application is train the training inside the application. Previous example is training using Google Colab and the train machine learning is inserted into the application. But in this another kind is training in the application. So you can train in class inside the framework. Before creating this interface, there is learning of. Okay, maybe there is another example. I forget the this. Oh. Okay, the characteristic of the training inside the application, we have to add some data to the application. Sorry, I forget the location. So the characteristic is we run, there is a training in a server. So we can retrain using the new data. Or you can integrate this application in another data using MySQL or another database management system and run regularly the retrain the data to make the better accuracy of the machine. Or you can use CSS or Bootstrap for the good presentation of the web application, and also you can implement this train machine learning to the mobile application, for example Android or iOS, and you can share to the world your application. Okay, I think it's enough for me. I will give the time to answer and question and answer and to please, moderator.
Thank you, Pak Rahmat, ya, for a very nice presentation, quite detail. We can see the difference between for the research, yeah, for bachelor degree and for postgraduate degree. So then I hope everybody here, especially those who are working as the lecturer, for example, if we want to push our student, then we have to know the limit of them. If they are postgraduate degree student, then of course we can go to that certain state like Pak Rahmadia just proposed just now during the presentation. So can I open like the first state, yeah, for the first three equation. If everybody have a question, you can type it in the chat room, or you can just raise your hand and I'm going to give you a time to ask. Anyone want to ask something or raise something or have another better idea, for example, or comment from the Dr. Ramadia presentation? Is it quite clear? So quiet here at the moment, everyone? Okay, I will wait for another 20 seconds. Okay, seems to be there is no question, so I will raise a couple of questions to Dr. Ramadia. Dr. Ramadia, you mentioned about the data set, yeah? That's quite nice list of the data set.
Yes.
My question is, the sum of the data set, sometimes there is no explanation about how they collect the data, and sometimes also the data they put only the field without an explanation. So from your experience so far, what is the best option for us to interpret, yeah, the every single field that they have, and also how they collect the data? Because maybe we need to know the behavior of the data, what kind of distribution that they have. We can calculate that, but we need to know also during the data collection, for example, what do they do? So what do you think about that? Thank you.
Okay, we get the data, we also have the metadata. So the metadata is important because it explains about what is the field, about its feature and its variable, etc. Some source give the metadata, especially the data source from government or from Kaggle for the competition. They will give the clear metadata. For example, I use the data for classifying the author. For example, there is some author that only first name and last name without middle name, first name without last name. It might be some girl change the family name into the another family name because the merit, etc. We can also need some description about where is the institution affiliation and what topics, so we can merge the, oh, this is the Teddy Mantoro and Teddy another is different, etc. For example, in the Kaggle is a clear discussion. But for the from big data, usually we can only get the raw data, so we have to use some manipulation from big data technique. For example, PCI, we can analyze from this variable, maybe for example 10 variable, maybe and only 3 or 5 that influence variable, so we can only analyze this specific variable and avoid another variable because they don't influence from the data. So we have to use another, for example, data text mining. If we get the data from the unstructured data or semi-structured, it is difficult, so we have to analyze and convert to the structured data before analyzing. It's just the domain of the NLTK, natural language processing, NLP. Okay. Oh, there is a question from Harry Suprihatin from tadi.
Yes, you can answer directly.
Different machine learning and deep learning. Okay. Machine learning contain a lot of method not only neural network. So I have for example, I use a support vector machine, which is for running another method using a. Okay, I share the screen again. This is I run the code using machine learning, a support vector machine. This is actually the same interface, but I use another method of machine learning. We call it support vector machine, sorry. We use the, where is the model, and this is a SVM library, SVM method using the scikit-learning. You can also see the inside code. For example, SVM. This is the SVM machine learning method. You can see how they the decision tree, where is a vector machine. Here's a linear or regression. Okay, I choose the, which is the code. You can see the source code. This is the contributor, and this is the class linear. There is a lot of method in machine learning, but deep learning only use some neural network with some preprocessing inside the deep neural network. For example, convolutional neural network use convolutional and another processing technique before backpropagation take part in this CNN. Another method, for example, recurrent neural network, or the famous one is LSTM, long short term memory, this to analyze the temporal data to predict with that, with some delay function to use the previous data again to the current process. RNN is famous for the temporal data. And another deep learning method still in progress, but current method, for example, VGG is have the high accuracy, maybe 99 or 98. It's difficult to our student to get the more higher accuracy than the current model. So we can only focus to the implementation of the current method, or we have to make the simple or minimum resource. For example, if we use another method better than deep learning in resource minimum computation, we can only choose the another candidate instead of deep learning. For example, if we detect the mass detection in our, for example, here, we can use another simple algorithm. For example, a mode detection. There is a Hart-Scarcat algorithm that create. We test the where is the eye, the nose, and the mode. It is a simple computation compared with using the CNN or VGG that need a lot of hour to training the model. I think every model have their own weakness and strong. Okay, I think it's enough.
All right, thank you, Pak Ramadia. There is still one more question, but the time is actually very limited because Bu Dini will be explain another presentation. But let me give you more time for Pak Ramada to answer the last question here for his presentation. If you have more question, you can chat directly to Pak Ramadia, and you can send personally using the chat here to Dr. Ramadia. So this is the question from Pak Yoga. I think you can read directly, ya, Pak Ramadia. What do you think from your perspective, for example, for the doctoral study of information system? This is talking about information system. What is that area for using the machine learning in this context? Okay, so he's looking for your insight. Please, Dr. Ramadia.
Yes, I think the information system is more easier than the computer science when if we research in machine learning, because we can only analyze some method and implement it to the organization or the in industry or in education, etc. And we focus on how to make the method is appropriate for the implementation. Yes, of course we have to learn lot of machine learning method, not only
kalau mobilnya orangnya mesti yang lah
or etc. We have only we have to learn more method. If you don't understand the some characters of the method, you can read the book or see the YouTube or ask your advisor about the learning method. Not deep study on your by your own time, because this is the difficult and need some time. So you have to learn fast of this machine learning method, because you focus to the domain of your information system. For example, if machine learning will implement in the, for example, IT security, you not only learn the machine learning method, but your accuracy IT security. If you want implement machine learning in the e-learning or mobile learning, you have to not only know understand the machine learning method, but also the e-learning system. So you have to focus on the system, but also, you have to understand fast as possible to understand the machine learning by a lot of terserah caranya gimana gitu ya. Kalau the easy one, you choose the easy one. You have the private, you have a webinar or a online course, etc. to understand this machine learning method that now available in YouTube, etc. That I think that easy to understand now compared to 90 or 2000 before YouTube and other social media is not available like now. Okay, Miss Yoga, Mr. Yoga, I hope you have the insight.
Thank you, Dr. Ramadia. That's quite clear, I believe. I think everybody already knows that in our area here we have like big two fields. Yeah. So number one, what we call as computer science, and the other one is of course the information science. And of course, like Dr. Media just mentioned, when we're talking about the information science, so we close to the implementation model basically. Whereas in the computer science, in terms of the methodology, so in term of the we try to find the scientific problem basically in term of the method, and we want to increase it and get the better accuracy. All right. So with that, thank you, Dr. Ahmadiyah, for your presentation, also for the answering all the question in the very good way. All right. So, Bapak dan Ibu sekalian, before we go to Bu Dini, let me sharing with you 2-3-5 minutes. One website that what I know this is quite heavy in term of the implementation of the use of the AI, or especially for CI, all right? So what is AI and what is CI? I think I explained already in the previous session. Let me sharing with you the slide. Actually, this one is at the moment used by a lot of office, including from KSP, yeah, from the president office, by the way. And I got the permission actually to sharing this, but of course you cannot access it directly. Yeah. So let me sharing that website about the monitoring of the COVID-19. So I hope everybody can see this picture, this website. Can you see everyone? No. Hello, can you see the screen that I see?
No, Prof. No.
Not yet, no. Prof. Blank. Okay, I see, Prof.
All right. Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your confirmation. Maybe still ongoing. So can you see premise COVID-19? Belum ya?
Yes.
All right, thank you for that.
Yes, yes, I see, Prof, yes.
All right, thank you for that. So if you see this application, actually this is the application that our president, how they see the COVID-19 in Indonesia, also around the world, all right? So a long time ago, I mean last year, I have a small team at this time, including Dr. Ramadi also. We do some prediction, all right? But after sometimes we stop because I saw a couple of other applications, they're working quite hard and they're using a lot of artificial intelligence approach and computational intelligence. So this is the monitoring of COVID-19 in the world. One of the strongest of this application is two things. Yeah? Number one is the quality of the data, because Indonesia, this is from Badan Intelijen Negara, by the way. So we have Perbinlu. So from the Perbinlu, they collect the other type of data and then putting it here. So that's quite rich data, yeah. So the next one is, let me share with you because the screen is not. And if you want to see the situation in Indonesia, this is our current situation for today, for example. So we have what they call by CFR. What is CFR? This is a case fatalistic rate, yeah? So how many people who are die, for example. So they came not only from one province, but also goes to until the, sometime until the kelurahan or kecamatan, gitu ya. And they have a real data, every single data, they collect the data and sending it directly. So if you scrolling down, so every single of the presentation here, they came from the using the AI algorithm, using computational intelligence. And this is, this one is only present, not only. I mean, this is the current situation that we have. Yeah, so not heavy competition, this is the presentation itself. All right. Now, let me show you the next one about the prediction. So for the prediction, like I mentioned earlier, the team, most of the member of the team was they are very strong programmer. They are some of them they cum laude from S1 and S2 in ITB, for example. So they are really a good brain actually, and we're feeding it with the very strong data, very complete set data, and every single day. All right. So this one is the today prediction, for example. of course you can zoom it, you can see for every single thing and so on, yeah. So, and this is the estimation for how many bed that we have, ventilator, APD, and also the isolation room that are available in the in Indonesia, yeah. There is a number of the COVID-19 from January and so on. They predict also. This is also using the computational intelligence and so on. Yeah. So I just want to, why I'm sharing this, because I just want to inform you that actually from the government, for example, they are doing quite well and they're using the right tools and choice the right tools and the right correct the data also. Now, as you know, after the after we have the vaccination, they start to open the school, for example, and also this team, they also, this is the product from the Puslitbang of Badan Intelijen actually. So as you can see also all the distribution of the process, the staging when they want to open the school, for example. If, for example, the rate was already green, then they, the policy, they are allowed to share and open the school. Yeah. So my point here is we working in AI and CI, computational intelligence. I hope you already quite clear the difference between AI and CI. And this is one place that we already implemented, okay? So you can see the epicentrum, for example, of the COVID-19. And we can see also the rate of the RT, yeah? And some prediction also. So if we see some place they have the higher one, something like this, so then the policy that we need to tighten the policy. And again, using the control basically. They also using for another application called Lacak. So everybody who got infected, we got the phone number and also the monitoring using the location using and their approach, all right? Just give you some idea, everyone here in the during this webinar that actually we already there is some place that they implemented quite heavy, yeah, in terms of the AI and CI. Okay, now we go to the second speaker. So let me read the brief CV of the Dr. Dini. Dr. Dini send us like 10 pages of his CV actually, so but I'm going to read it only a couple of things that maybe related with this presentation. Okay, so Dr. Dini research interest is in the brain computer interaction and also in the effective computing. I know her since she is the PhD student in Malaysia. She is the lecturer in Taylor University. And I have a very close relation with the Taylor University currently. Me myself also as the adjunct prof in Taylor University, and together with Dr. Dini, we have one PhD student currently. Yeah. And then the area of the expertise for Dr. Dini, number one is she is expert in the expert system, machine learning and fuzzy logic, and also in the computational linguistic, natural languages processing, and sentiment analysis, like Dr. Rahmadia just mentioned previously. When we see the big data, for example, we're going to see one variable, what they call bivariety. Yeah? Under the variety, we can see the structured data and unstructured data, and like free data, like no database data. So one of the tools that we can use is of course the natural language processing, and Dr. Dini also working in the area of computational linguistic. And she also working in the cognitive science, yeah, especially in brain computer interaction. I think when she doing his PhD before, she's working in the brain computer interaction. And then he teaching mostly in the computer science area. She got a lot of publication and trying to find his just a moment. He got his PhD from IIUM, International Islamic University of Malaysia. Yeah. So, okay, without further ado, I would like to invite Dr. Dini to present his work in let her to explain it to you, everyone. So with that, please, Dr. Dini, I think your time is about 45 minutes. And then after that, we're going to have the question and answer. And there is one feedback. I will ask you to give us 1 or 2 minutes feedback. And after that, we close the session. Hopefully, we can finishing off at 12 o'clock. So with that, please, Dr. Dini.
Thank you very much. Can you hear my voice, Prof?
Not yet.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you clear.
Yes, I hear me.
Thank you very much for this opportunity, Prof. Teddy. So, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Very good morning.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
To all the participants, ladies and gentlemen. So, I would like to share my screen now.
Budini, you have a background voice, actually a noise.
Oh, all right. Wait, bro.
Yes, my. All
right.
Yeah, but now, bro, is it okay?
Yep, yeah, it's more clearer.
Okay, can you see my screen?
Yep, it's quite clear.
All right, thank you. So today I would like to discuss or maybe share my interest in this research. So the title of this webinar is Toward the Heart of the Machine, the Future in Artificial Emotional Intelligence. So this is me. My name is Dini Oktarina Dwi Handayani from School of Computer Science and Engineering, Faculty Innovation and Technology, Taylor's University, Malaysia. But at the moment, I also teach in the Nusa Putra University for the master program together with Dr. Rahmadia and Prof. Teddy also. So for those who want to know more about the artificial intelligence specifically, and if you want to pursue your master, you can try to communicate with us. Maybe we can give you some solution for your further your study. Okay, so maybe I will close my video, yeah, to make it the connection. Good. Okay, so before we start our discussion today, so I would like to share first about the affective computing, because previously I'm talking about the emotional intelligence. So emotion or affect, so what is actually correlate with the computing? So there is one field of study named the affective computing. So this field of study is the interdisciplinary field. So combined between computer science, psychology, and also the cognitive science. The affective computing is the study and development of system and device that can be used to recognize, interpret, process, and simulate the human affect. Okay, next. So there is a lot of definition of affective computing. So we can refer to any definition. So for me, I would like to follow the definition from the Picard. So affective computing is the ability for the computer to recognize and express human emotion. Then the computer is try to identify, understand, and give the feedback similar with the emotion of a human. So we are talking about the emotion. So what is exactly emotion? So sometimes we can use emotion, and sometimes people say about mood. So actually emotion and mood is two different things. So emotion is a chemical release in response to our interpretation of specific trigger. So it takes our brain about a quarter second to identify the trigger itself, and about another quarter second to produce the chemical in our body. And the emotion chemical are released throughout our body. Yeah? It's not only in our brain. So what is mood and what is the difference between emotion and mood? So because sometimes we use term mood and emotion, but I'm not sure, maybe not all understand what is the difference between emotion and mood. So actually mood is longer than emotion. Okay, and mood is more general, and mood also influenced by several factors. Yeah, the most influenced factor for mood is environment, and sometimes mood can be because of your own problem, or maybe because of your friend, or maybe your job, and some other things. And most mood longer than emotion. It can be about a minute or maybe hour, and also possible to have your mood for days, even for a week. Okay, so why we are talking about emotion, and why emotion is important? Because emotion can affect human judgment, human perception, and also decision-making process. So that's why we have to know our emotion. So later, when we decide something or we want to give some suggestion, we have to consider our emotion. So when we are giving the decision, it's not because our emotion is what we call it more to how to explain that. Maybe if we are it's not in the good emotion, most probably we are not giving the good decision. So something like that. So when we are talking about affective computing, so for today's webinar, I will divide into first about the affective model, and the second one is the emotion elicitation, and next is to self-assessment test, how we collect the affective data, and the last one, human display emotion. Okay, so for the affective model, there are two types of affective model that we can refer to. So first is the discrete model, referring to the Ekman. The Ekman proposed six basic emotion as a discrete. We can call it as a fear, anger, joy, sadness, disgust, and surprise emotion. On the other hand, we also can model the affective as a dimension. First, we can translate emotion as a two-dimension model, like valence and arousal. And the second type of dimension is three-dimension, where we try to translate emotion into valence, arousal, and dominance, or some other theory using valence, tension, and energy. So this is the affective model. So the figure A, referring to Russell circumplex model. So this referring to two dimension affective state. So as we can see here, the x-axis referring to valence, we can refer to the positive valence and negative valence, and the y-axis referring to arousal. We have here arousal, positive arousal and negative arousal. So if you think the discrete emotion is not enough to explain about your emotion, or maybe you want to have the specific number of your emotional state, so you can use this affective model, whether you want to use the two dimension or three dimension. So in this sample, the figure number A referring to the Russell circumflex model, I think this one around 1980, yeah, the theory is old already, but we still refer to this two-dimension model. So for example, if you are referring to the happy emotion, as you can see on the figure, you can refer to the positive valence and also high arousal. Okay, so if you are referring to the positive valence, but the arousal is not too high, so most probably you are referring to the calm emotion and so on. The same thing, if you are referring to the negative emotion, if the degree of arousal is high, most probably your emotion is referring to the fear, distress, or maybe angry. Angry also in the similar quadrant with fear and distress. And for the sad, bored, and tired, is referring to the negative emotion and low arousal. And the figure B is the Shimek and Grob model, is referring to three dimension emotional state. So referring to the valence, similar, yeah? Valence, the positive valence and negative valence. So the second dimension is energy, positive energy and negative energy. And the third dimension is tension, whether you have the high tension or positive tension or a low tension or referring to the negative tension. Okay, next is the emotion elicitation. So in order to get the emotion data, one of the factors that has a significant impact on the model of emotion is the use of elicitation. Yeah, so there is a lot of type of emotion elicitation. So here I give you some sample. For example, later you want to do the emotion elicitation using text, so you can refer to this data set. So for example, here Amazon product data set, Stanford sentiment, Tree Bank, IMDb, movie review data set, and so on. So all these data set we can use as the emotion elicitation using text. So as we know, even when we read something, we can feel the emotion. Yeah. So if you want to collect the emotion data, first thing you can use, I mean, the first elicitation model that you can so sound, for example, you can refer to the International Affective Digital Sound Set, or IADS, or Ryzen Audiovisual Database of Emotional Speech and Song, or RAVDIS, and other sample. If you are referring to music, also possible to do the emotion elicitation. But the one, I mean, here, the as you can see on this, on the screen, is the validated data set. So no worries with the quality of data set because it's already validated by psychologists. Okay, the next sample for emotion elicitation is using image. Okay, so the sample, you can refer to the International Affective Picture System, or IAPS, or maybe if you prefer using other, you can use the Geneva Affective Picture Database or Nansky Affective Picture System, or NAPS. Okay, so for image itself, if you are talking about the race, different race can have different picture. Yeah. So if you referring to specific race for your emotion elicitation, maybe you have to read in detail the data set that you plan to use. For example, here IAPS is general, so it's not only consists of human image, it also consists of animal, landscape, and so on. And another sample from image, you can refer to the RAFD or the Radboud data set, but RAFD only focusing to the kids image. So for example, you plan to do the emotion elicitation for kids, it's better to use the kids image, because if referring to the emotional state, we can get the good quality of data if we choose the correct emotion elicitation. So for example, age also have to be considered when you choose the emotion elicitation. And the last one, the sample of emotion elicitation is video. You can refer to the SIWA database. Video is considered as the strongest emotion elicitation because it's a combination between video and audio and visual, yeah, together. And sometimes in the video, you also can put text, so to make it more strong. Okay, so next, for the data collection itself, we can refer to the self-assessment test using the survey, using the same like similar as the questionnaire. So what you can see in the screen is the self-assessment mannequin. So this is referring to the two-dimension emotion. So for example, if you want to do the data collection using the discrete emotion, so meaning your participant only need to write down what kind of emotion they feel. For example, they feel angry, then just write angry, or maybe feel happy and so on. But for the self-assessment mannequin, we can refer to the valence and arousal. So for example, the first group of image is referring to the valence, negative to positive. So you can see the image is different. We have 5 image here, number 1 until number 9. So if you feel something in between, then for example, between 1 and 3, then you just choose number 2, or maybe it's not that happy, it's not a maximum happiness, but maybe still happy, then you can choose 8, okay? And this self-assessment is not only use valence, because we are referring to the two-dimensional model. So the second group of image is arousal. So the degree of intensity. So for example here, if you feel, it's not that excited, so maybe you can just choose 1 or maybe choose 3 and so on. The different figure here referring to different degree of intensity. So for this sample self-assessment mannequin, is referring to the raso emotional dimension, which is only 2 dimension. So the next is one. This is similar, the self-assessment mannequin, but you can see the difference. Yeah? Here we have 3 set of image. The first image is referring to valence, the positive emotion and negative emotion. And the second set of image is referring to the arousal, to the degree of intensity. And the last image is referring to the dominance. You can see the small image referring to the non-dominance, and until the point number 9 is referring to more dominant image. Okay, so this is referring to 3-dimensional emotional state. But some questionnaire have the image number 4, whether the participant is like or dislike. So usually using the thumbs up or or thumbs down. But for my personal opinion, if we are referring to like or dislike, is not considered as emotion. It's referring to your own perception. Whether you like the video or you dislike the video, then you just choose which perception, whether you want to give the thumb ups or thumbs down. Okay. Next. Then how to correlate the affective computing with human? So as we know, human also display emotion. And as a computer scientist, we want to try to quantify the emotion. So for example, if we are referring to face, then we can work with the face recognition. So if we referring to the face, we can see the difference of emotion for every human. Whether this person have the happy emotion at the time or maybe sad and so on. So you can refer the face to recognize the human emotion. The second one, you can also use voice to recognize the human emotion. So you can feel the emotion from the voice, whether maybe your parent angry to you, or maybe your lecturer is angry to you, so you can feel the emotion from the voice recognition. And you also can see the gesture, the human gesture. Yeah. So whether your friend is in the happy emotion or maybe sad, you also can see through the gesture. However, face, voice, and gesture, you can falsify. Similar with the self-assessment mannequin, sometimes we can give the incorrect perception. For example, you are actually in the sad emotion. Yeah, you are very sad. Maybe you have the family problem and so on. But you want to hide your sadness. Then you can just use your smiley face, okay? So others can only see you are in the happy emotion, yeah? Similar with voice. So I think you also have the experience, maybe call the customer service. I don't think when you call the customer service, you will hear the sad voice from the customer service. So meaning, voice also can be falsified. We can hide our emotion, then still showing we are in the happy emotion or maybe in the neutral emotion. So body gesture also similar. So different with the physiological signal. We cannot control the physiological signal. For example, your heartbeat, your maybe the heart rate, and also the brainwave. This kind of physiological signal, we cannot control. So whatever inside your brain, whatever inside your heart is will be your real emotion. Okay, so later after you got all this physiological signal or maybe the other affective data, you can translate into the affect expression. You can identify whether this guy is happy, this guy is fear, or from the voice, maybe this guy is scared or so on. Okay. So since my research interest is more to the brain-computer interface, so I will give sample on how to conduct the experiment for collecting the data from brainwave. Okay, so the experimental setup more or less something like this. So first, we have the brainwave device. So this one you can purchase, yeah, but it's not for the education and the research purpose. It's not necessary to have very high amount of channel. For me, for this sample, only have 14 channel. So I will ask the participant to wear this EEG device, and at the same time, We have to prepare the signal analysis machine because during the data collection, we have to record all the data. Then later, we translate whether this participant in which affective state. Okay. Then at the same time, this participant also have to look at this presentation screen. So here, when we display the emotion elicitation, so it's up to you whether you want to give the text or whether you want to play the video and so on. Okay, so for this experimental setup, previously I give one task for the participant for driving because I want to know the emotion of this participant during driving. But at the time, I'm not collect the the real data from the car. So I'm using the driving simulator. I want to know this the emotion of this participant during the driving. So as you know, in the traffic, 70% of accident because of human factor. Yeah, the 30% can be because the environment or maybe because the car itself, but 70% because of the human error. So it can be because the driver is fatigued or maybe the driver is not in the good mood, maybe have a fighting with the couple or some other thing. So at the time, I try to identify whether this participant is a good driver or maybe have some problem during driving. Okay, so this is the pipeline of physiological sensing of affective computing. So this is really near with the one that Dr. Rahmadia shared before. So for this case, for the affective computing, we divide into two different stages. First is aspect of human physiology, and the second one is aspect of emotion theory. So in the aspect of human physiology, first you have to collect the data. Maybe during the data collection, you also have to decide what kind of emotion elicitation that you want to use for stimulate the emotion and what kind of device you want to use and so on. And after you give the physiological sensing, you will get the physiological data. Then after you get the physiological data, you go to the next stage, this combination between the human physiology and also emotion theory. So whether you refer to the two-dimension model or maybe you refer to three-dimension model or maybe you refer to discrete emotion, it doesn't matter. So in this stage, you have to do the feature extraction and also classification. Okay, after you finish the process, you will have the emotion representation. Then after this, it's up to you whether you want to implement this emotion representation in any application that you prefer to have together with the effective computing. So for example here, the sample of implementation of the effective computing can be used in the marketing, customer service, human resource, healthcare, and so on. So for example, but I'm not going to explain in detail, yeah, one by one. Just give some example for the use effective computing application in marketing. So you can use as a marketing communication, and also you can use as the market research or maybe the content optimization. Yeah. So effective computing can help your business to generate content that can maybe communicate well with your customer. And in different case for the customer service, we can use the effective computing application as the intelligent call routing, or maybe recommendation during call, or maybe if you want to use as the continuous improvement. Okay, so it's good if you can feel the emotion of your customer, then maybe you can improve your service to make your customer happy. In human resource, effective computing also very important. So maybe you can implement the effective computing application for the recruitment and maybe for the tracking employee satisfaction, because you want to know whether your employee is feeling happy during the working time or maybe feeling pressure and so on. In the healthcare, it's very important to implement effective computing. You can use the effective computing application to improve the patient care or maybe to help in the medical diagnosis. And at the same time, you also can use the effective computing for counseling. Okay, next, another example for the insurance. Maybe you can use as the fraud detection. So all this application is using machine learning and deep learning, yeah, for sure. So it's really close with Dr. Rahmadia's work. And for the retail, you can use as the in-store shopping experience. Maybe you can put one video to analyze your customer experience. Then if you feel maybe you can identify your customer is not happy, you can give some maybe personal touch to the customer. And next sample for the driving assistant is also very good to give the safety driver and also to checking the driving performance. Because sometimes when you drive and you feel maybe a bit sleepy, is also difficult, yeah, to have concentration while driving. Maybe if you have the effective computing application, this application can give you some alert, maybe ask you to take a rest for a while, because if you push to drive, maybe accident will happen. And for the education, is also very important. Later, I will share my ongoing research on education. So we can try to measure the effectiveness of the teaching and learning activity. And for the government, we can use as the tracking or the maybe estimate the citizen reaction, or maybe later for the during campaign, we can also use as a tool to understand the general mood of the population and so on. Game, of course, we can use effective computing for game, for the gaming. And the last one is the technology together with IoT. We can integrate the effective computing maybe to control the smart home, yeah, like previous work from Prof. Teddy. So if together with effective computing, I think it's very good. Maybe if the person is not in the good mood or maybe feel sad, maybe automatic music will on or some other thing, yeah, we can implement together IoT and effective computing. All right, so this is the sample of effective computing application. You can download if you want to know more about the Affectiva. So Affectiva is the emotion database. Is also Emotion SDK and API. You can use Affectiva as a virtual assistant or personalized transportation experience. And also Affectiva can be used as advertising. You can use it to understand and make emotional engagement for your customer, for example. And another example is Pepper. Okay, so Pepper use the voice recognition together with face recognition and also body movement. So actually Pepper use the emotion recognition API from Affectiva. So you can see the response from Pepper through the eye color, and we can give our response through the tablet or maybe from the tone of your voice. So if you go to Japan, you can see Pepper in bank. So Some of bank no more customer service, now only paper to deal with the customer. And also as the, in Indonesia, I think we call it as the SPG, right? The sales promotion girl. And in Japan, only use the paper to promote the Nescafe. And it's not only in the bank and also in a store. You can also see paper in the elderly house. In Indonesia, maybe we call it as a rumah jompo. Yeah, so some older people, maybe the kids send the parent to the rumah jompo, and the elderly also need friend. So they bought paper for their parent to as a friend for the parent itself. Okay, so I think next I will share my current research, but I cannot share into detail, just give you the general information because this is the ongoing research from my master student. So the title is Profiling of Pornography Addiction Among Children Using Neurophysiological Computational Model, or NCM. So the main idea is similar. Collect the brainwave from the participant, and we try to identify whether this participant is having the porn addiction or maybe health participant. At the time, we have collaboration with Yayasan Kita dan Bu Hati under the Ibu Eli Risman. So they provide us the patient. So it's not our side to label the participant, whether this participant is having the porn addiction or no. The labeling is from the expert, from the psychologist. So we only try to identify and also see the interesting pattern, to see the different brain pattern between the porn addiction children and non-porn addiction. So this is still in progress. Then the next ongoing research is, I call it SADA. SADA is the BCI-based Student Attention Deficit Alert and Profiling System for Effective Learning. So the main idea is similar. From the brainwave, we try to identify whether the student in the high attention or maybe in the low attention. As you know, we are facing the online situation, yeah? So sometimes we push ourselves to still sitting in front of our laptop, but we never realize that our attention level maybe is already low. So with this application, here I'm not only identify whether the attention is low, moderate, or high. Additional features from this system is the neurofeedback. So after I get the result from the attention identification, so we try to give the feedback to the participant. For example, if the attention level is low, then we give the alert, the warning message, something like maybe you better take a rest to make your attention level high, or maybe to just give you a relaxed time. So after get the alert from the machine, so the participant can decide whether want to take rest or maybe stop for a while, not continue study and so on. And after 10 minutes, maybe it's enough to take a rest, then continue study. Then if the attention level is still low, again, the warning alert will appear to the participant. Okay, I think in my side, I don't have a lot of slide to share at the moment. So if you have a question, feel free to give me a question. Or if I cannot answer all the question, you can email me to dinioktana.dwihandaini@tellers.edu.my. All right, thank you very much, Prof. Teddy.
Thank you, Dr. Dini, for your very nice and inspiring presentation. So for the audience, welcome for if you have any question. Please continue join us until in the end because I have a couple announcement and I'm going to share also a couple slides after this. Maybe you interested with a couple of program that we have. Okay, any question, please? You can raise your hand, you can just speak directly, or you can just type also in our chatting room there. Okay, there is one question, Dr. Dini, in the chat room from Harry Suprihatin. So can you explain how do machine learn to read emotion, yeah? And what opportunity are there for AI, for artificial emotional intelligence in business? Okay. And there is another second question, just in case you want to answer in one go. Okay. From Haris Riono Sigit. The question is about the effective computing application. How the application can detect whether someone is pretending or not based on figure, voice, or gesture, pretending of they showing that this is not him or something like that. All right, okay. So I think I'm almost close with that. So okay. Please, Dr. Dini.
Okay, thank you, Prof. So the first question, can you explain how do machine learn to read emotion? Learn how to read emotion. I think your question is how to make sure the machine understand whether we are in the happy emotion, whether we are in the fear and other emotion. So as I mentioned earlier, we are using the emotion elicitation. So the first thing we have to do is collect the reference emotion. So for example, we showing the emotion of happy. Then we collect the data, meaning we already have the emotion of happy. Then we try to collect another data with, for example, maybe calm emotion. Then we already have two set of different emotion. Then with the help of machine learning will learn from the pattern, which one is the happy pattern, which one is the calm pattern. Then later, if we want to test whether this participant in the happy or other emotion, we use the current model, the current emotion model. So when we test the data, machine will translate whether the pattern is in happy emotion or maybe in the calm emotion. Okay, so hope that help. Also hope that answer your question. And what opportunity are there for artificial emotion intelligence in business? There is a lot of opportunities. For example, I have my friend doing the PhD last time, yeah, and try to identify the human emotion during the I try to explain in Indonesia, yeah, Prof. Teddy.
Jadi, yeah, please do.
Kawan saya coba identify emotion seseorang waktu membeli saham. Jadi mungkin waktu dia happy, dia akan beli saham. Waktu dia sedih, mungkin dia akan menjual saham. Jadi that kind of situation we also can identify. If we want to sell saham, for example, if we feel your friend is happy, and most probably will buy something, then that is the good time that you try to sell something to your friend. So it's also work in business. You can play around with your customer emotion. Then if you touch the emotion at the your customer feeling, then the customer will buy your product for sure. So if you're referring to the advertisement from Bangkok, I think Prof. Teddy and Dr. Rahmadia very familiar, yeah, with advertisement in Bangkok. If you, I try to recall your memory, yeah. Bangkok is very good giving the emotion feeling on the advertisement. So when we feel something, for sure we will buy that product. Actually, sometimes they try to sell the SIM card, but the behind the story maybe lose the parent or maybe lose the sibling. with that kind of emotion, sometimes customer no need to think twice, then we bought the product. So we play around with the emotion. Okay, then next question. I would like to ask Mikini about effective computing, how the application can detect whether someone is pretending or not based on figure, voice, or gesture. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, figure, voice, and gesture is easy to falsify. So we can try to, we can pretend we are in the happy emotion, but in actually no. So it's not easy. And the effective computing, computing actually is not the lie detector. So I don't, this is beyond my ability at the moment. So I cannot say that the effective computing can detect the pretending something through the figure, voice, or gesture. Okay, I think next is, what about effective computing apps according to the consciousness and awareness? Okay, so this one also very good, yeah. Consciousness and awareness, maybe it's depend on the context itself. So when previously I explained about the driving, yeah, just one case about the driving. For example, if you feel you can set the drowsiness, for example, is not the effective actually, but still using the brainwave, when you can identify your driver is drowsy or maybe sleepy, you can combine with the mobile app, maybe give some alert, like a voice and something to make your driver awake. So that's the case of consciousness and awareness. I think similar with other case, you can try to adjust the condition, but the main idea is to get the condition from your brain. Okay.
Is there any question again from the audience today? Okay. I count until three. I'm not expect to count until 100, by the way.
Okay, can the effective computing app can install a robotic nurse? Yes, for sure. So Pepper is one example of the robotic application using the effective computing. So you can also create your own robotic nurse. Okay, so in AI, maybe we are not the engineering person who can moving around the robot, but you can think about the chatbot. Okay, so it's still a robot, but static.
All right, thank you, Dr. Dini. Last chance, last question, please, if you still have any question, everyone. Of course, after this finish, you can still sending the chat to Dr. Dini. And if you have other question, then you can go to the offline, other than this website discussion, by the way. There is still a question. If there is no question, so I would like to thanks to Dr. Dini, yeah, for the presenter, the second presenter. So with a lot of, I think, new idea, yeah, in the area of the effective computing. So with that, thank you, Dr. Dini.
Thank you, Prof.
Yeah. So before we close, everyone, we have still two small agenda. Let me allow you to, please allow me to share with you what is the postgraduate study and what we have currently. Yeah. Let me share the quick slide here, only a couple of slides, by the way. I will make it as quick as possible so you get some idea what we are doing here. So for your information, currently, where is it? Just a moment, let me share my slide first. Oops, sorry. Yep. Okay. So before I start, we have a strong data actually about the situation in Indonesia in relation to the quality of the lecturer. All right. So in Indonesia, we have 292,561 lecturer according to PDDIKTI. And really unfortunate, only 7.7% of all the lecturer are in the area of, or close the area of the information technology, right, or IT. And among the 24,659 lecturer, only 1,119, that the number of the lecturer with the PhD quality, yeah, with the PhD level. So then at the time we thinking, how about if we help the government to raise also the PhD degree? But really unfortunate, to get the PhD degree, yeah, to running the PhD degree, you have to have the master degree program. So because of that, then I think 2 years back, I discussed with a couple of my friends, how about we running the computer science program? So there you go, we have the master of computer science at the moment, and we embedded in the school of computer science in Nusa Putra University in Sukabumi. But again, if you are, for example, working in the different city, for example, you still possible to join us, by the way, by using the online mode. Using hybrid, they are allowed by the government, but the student in some state, they have to visit the university, yeah, at least like 1 year, or 1 or 2 times, that should be enough. Our master degree student here, they're running for 2 years. And starting this year, actually we try to open the 4 PhD degree with collaborate using license from other university, from other countries, from Malaysia in this context. Yeah. So let us let me share with you briefly about this program. So this is the license from the university. This university already 20 years, by the way, around 20 years in the field. And they have like 10 program of bachelor degree, and then 2 program in for diploma 3, and 1 program for master degree. This is the one that we have. Is the license that we have for master degree level, yeah, back to the 3rd of October 2019. At the time we lucky, we have 26 students for the first batch, and one of them was a foreigner, yeah. And the first batch now just nearly finished, actually 3 of them just finished his thesis defense. And this is our curriculum. We concentrate only 2 things, one in artificial intelligence and the other one in the cyber security. And couple of the lecturer, I think you know already, one is Dr. Dini just now, and Dr. Kurniawan. I have my close friend from ANU, Australian National University. And also this is Bu Julita, he's graduated from RMIT. And when he doing his bachelor, he got honors and then go directly doing PhD. Pak Umar, me, and also Prof. Media here. All right. So still a couple of them, by the way, but I cannot put it here in the list because they're doing in the part-time basis, right? And this is the entry requirement, just in case your family, your friend, they want to do your bachelor degree. We have 2 program, one in English and the other one in Bahasa. In the first semester, still in Bahasa Indonesia, but slowly by slowly, we try to increase, yeah, the language that we going to use the English in the media of communication, by doing. So at least you're going to have the BSE as usual, 2.75, yeah, it's quite clear and quite easy basically. And we have the second batch, yeah. Currently we have only second batch. We waiting for running that topic. Okay. We lucky currently we have like 10 students. Actually, they came from a couple countries. Yeah, currently we have the international student from 5 countries, including Afghanistan, Aljazair, Cameroon, Madagascar, and Pakistan. And maybe you ask how we can get the student. So I'm lucky. I have couple friend. he is the ambassador of couple countries, so we approach them, and also we have a team marketing who approach the student from them. These 10 students, currently we give them all a full scholarship to study in our master degree level, all right? So just for your information. And this slide, try to show you like 3 students. They just finished last week, actually. And they working in cybersecurity and in artificial intelligence, okay? So you can see a couple student here. This is under our my supervisor, for example. Ivana actually working with Dr. Ramadia, and this one with Prof. Media, by the way, tracking user location indoor using AI. Yeah. So this just to give you some idea what kind of program that we have, and we again we have like 2 program. One is international program or professional program. And this is for the PhD degree, still under the preparation, but hopefully in the end of this month, on April, we can settle the MOU with the one university in Kuala Lumpur, UniKL, and we can running this PhD degree in this coming September. So just in case you're interested to do your PhD, for example, this is also one chance, yeah? So, is it also possible, like at the moment, UPN, ya, Universitas Pembangunan itu, ya, yeah, we plan to have one MOU with them, and then because maybe couple lecturer will join together the PhD degree, then they will be here in Indonesia, but they need to go to Malaysia for couple weeks, maybe at least 3 weeks to get the visa, and then they continue study from Indonesia, all right? And why we do this again? Because we want to increase the quality of the lecturer. So when the lecturer was quite strong in terms of the knowledge, for example, skill and capability and competency, for example, then our expectation is the student will also increase the quality also. So this one actually the idea came from this meeting. So our president just met Prime Minister of Malaysia, Muhyiddin Haji Yassin, on the 6th March, actually. Okay. Yeah, on Jumat, on the 5th, and on the Saturday, on the 6th March. So they have lunch together and so on. So they collaborate especially into area. Number one is economics matters, the other one is in the social and budaya. We call it as Gatra social budaya, and education is under that social budaya. And the president, according to the information that we got, the president mentioned to the prime minister that we ask for the assistance to increase the quality of our lecturer, especially for the university who are in the middle side. So just reflect to your university, for example, or your study program, how many PhD that you have. If most of your lecturer is they got the PhD, then hopefully they hopefully your university is in the good shape. Yeah, in the good shape. But if in your study program you have only 1 or 2 or maybe none, so maybe this one is one chance for you to increase your quality to get the PhD degree. And after that, the foreign minister, they asked his refuse the vice or deputy higher education. His name is Dato' Professor, I forget now the name. So that guy, actually, we contact them and we have some discussion. And for the computer science, we happy to inform everybody that they asked me to become the hub for the this kind of collaboration. All right. So again, my point is this is the communication between in the technical matter with the dean or the vice dean of UNIKL, yeah. And then this is the potential collaboration with the current university that we are going to explore, right? And then UNIKL is one of the university. It's quite sometime in Malaysia. And in terms of the ranking is actually in the middle, not in the top one in Malaysia. And why in the middle? Because according to the direction from our government also, we're not going to join or collaborate in this context between UI, ITB, UGM, and with the top university in Malaysia, like UM, UTM, and so on. But we go to the middle. So, and UNIKL quite have some time at the moment in the BD degree, so that's why we going to run working together with them, and we expect to start in the early of September 2021. I think that's all, everyone, to give some idea about the university that we, the study program that we have. Yeah, so again, currently we have the master degree program. They're running quite well at the moment. And then the other one is the PhD degree that we expect in the end of September, so we can run again the PhD degree. Okay, so if you have any question, maybe you can email us. This is our contacts, yeah, SOCS in Saputra, ICNID. Okay, so I think that's all for the introduction of that our program. And in the last part, we're going to have a feedback from everyone from this webinar. So can I invite Sister Fata ya, to share with us on how we do the feedback.
Bilangin nih.
Okay, Sister Fata, please.
Mrs. Fata, Prof. Teddy, sorry.
Okay, it's alright. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Before we are close the session webinar series, please now we will feedback session. So please in the chat from Zoom, I will share about the rule. Okay, the next session is a feedback. So please, Mr. and Mrs., everybody, open the browser application. Maybe you can open Mozilla or Google Chrome. And then please enter the URL www.menti.com. I will share screen, please. Yes?
Yeah, go ahead. You can share your screen.
Okay. This is, yes, everybody can type the from the browser, can use Mozilla or Google Chrome, and then type the www.menti.com, something like that. And then please enter the code. The code is this one, 4185 8148. I will share to Zoom chat. Okay, everybody can paste from the chat the code 4185 8148. And then please give the feedback from this webinar series. What do you think of today's webinar activity in three words? Please give the impression of this webinar activities in the morning. What do you think of today's webinar activities in three words? I will get again. Everybody can open the browser, can use Mozilla or Google Chrome, and then everybody can type www.menti.com, and then enter the code 4185 8148, and everybody can paste from the Zoom chat. And then please give the feedback. What do you think of today's webinar activity in 3 words? Okay, for the next session, please read today's webinar activities. First, about the benefit of today's webinar event. Two, about topic material on today's webinar from the narasumber. And three, desire for continuation of similar webinar activities. So everybody can write today's webinar activities. Okay, I think it's enough. Thank you for your participation in providing feedback on today's webinar activities. And now I will give to Mr. Prof. Teddy Mantoro. Thank you. Thank you, Prof.
Yeah, thank you, Miss Pata. Yeah.
Yes, Miss Pata. Nice. Nice to meet you, Prof.
Okay. All right, that's good. So everyone, for those who are not joined our WhatsApp group in CIS and IDNNS, please join us also. Let me give you the link. Let me set the link for you to join the group here. Yeah, this moment. Give me 1 second. Let me set up one link to allow you, just in case you are not joined our WA group. So invite the link. One second, please. There you go. Sorry, I'm not preparing, just come up with my mind to share with you about this idea. Yeah, so I just put it in the chat here. Yeah, thank you, Miss or Sister Sister Fatah. Yeah, and then so I just sharing the link
for the
chat. So if for those who are not joined the WA group, WhatsApp group of our CIS community, Computational Intelligence Society, and Indonesian Neuronetic Society, you just click and then from your WhatsApp and you can join us. And this one is for free. Yeah? No, there is no charge, nothing actually. So you just join, and if you have some experience, you can sharing also with them. Okay, I hope you get already the all the information here. So okay, everyone. So I think that's already come to the end of our discussion here. So I would like to thanks again to the two speakers for their very nice insight, yeah, and expressive also from Dr. Rahmadia and Dr. Dini. And also I would like to invite you also if you would like to join to our program, to join to our master degree level and PhD degree level in our program that we have here, and also to join the WhatsApp group of the CIS and IDNNS. Okay, And we're going to have a couple others webinars in the next couple weeks. And so hopefully you can join again with our next webinar. So I think that's all for today webinar. And before we close, because I think in 1 or 2 days, maybe tomorrow, we're going to start our Ramadan times. So we would like to maaf lahir batin ya. Selamat Saum Ramadan di hari esok. So sebelum kita tutup, mohon mengaktifasi screen masing-masing, kita akan foto bersama. Tolong Bu Elok ya, Bu Elok dari postgraduate dari program kita untuk mengcapture gambarnya. Bu Elok, silakan Bu Elok yang lead Bu Elok. Suaranya belum belok.
Yeah, please on your camera. I will take our picture first. Yeah, 3, 2, 1, stay here. Okay, thank you. Sudah ya? Oke, okay, Prof, sudah.
Oke. Okay. So, thank you everyone. So, hopefully we can meet again in the next webinar. Thank you ya semuanya ya. Pak Afri, thank you for coming, Pak Afri Yadi.
Ya, sama-sama, Prof.
Ya, yeah, Pak Heri, semuanya ya, Jajang, Pak Jajang.
Ya, Pak.
Ya, Prof. Banyak, ya. Pak.
Thank you, Prof.
Ya, yeah, thank you. Terima kasih sama-sama. Anton, jangan hilang-hilang ya, Anton. Nanti jumpa saya ya.
Ya, Pak.
Ya,
ya Pak.
Oke, Kang Solihin. Terima kasih buat datang, Kang Solihin. Buat semua ya, terima kasih semua. Oke ya, saya tutup semuanya ya. Terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.